You're on.
Thank you. I'm going to call this meeting of the Arundel Planning Board, regular meeting, August 25th, 2016, at 7:06 PM, call it to order. Start with a roll call.
Marty Gane.
Jamie Lauer.
Rich Ganong.
Chip Bassett.
Roger Moran.
Tom McGinn.
Tad Ledway Planner.
I'm not on the board.
Okay. We have before us, first, we need to approve the agenda. We have a new application for Lovejoy Builders, registration of existing contractor yard. We will need to amend the agenda because Mr. Lovejoy has asked that we table this item.
Reason?
Did he give a reason?
He wanted to consult with the buyer on another, on several matters first.
Okay.
Thank you.
Under other business, we have Brookside Estates, a discussion of non-compliance issues. Then we have the land use ordinance revisions, proposed amendments to the land use ordinance. There are some conflicts in there. Plan is important, and we will adjourn and call it a night.
Yeah, the new, okay, never mind. Wait a minute. Comment from the public?
On the agenda?
Yeah, we have always had a place beforehand. We were supposed to leave a place for comment from the public or anything else.
But that's in relation to specific items, not to the agenda itself.
Other things out of the agenda. We've had that before, sir.
Okay. Is there anything anybody in the audience would like to add to the agenda? Or comment? Hearing none?
I'm wondering if we accept any questions.
Okay.
Minutes from our last meeting?
Yes.
The more we accept this agenda.
As amended. Because we have to take Lovejoy off.
Okay.
Okay, motion has been made to approve the agenda as amended.
Second.
Made and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor? Is unanimous. That brings us to Brookside Estates. We have if you remember back on, I was not here, but back on August 11th, the board requested that a letter go out to the CEO concerning non-compliance and not issuing building permits. The last time we had J Group on the agenda was on June 9th, and it was a no-show situation. So we discussed it. There are a couple of issues of non-compliance that we need to look at. We have not gotten a bond. We were supposed to get a $152,000 bond. We were told repeatedly, starting back in April, that bond was coming. And there was the issue of the clear cut along Log Cabin Road for the, is it 100 feet long? I believe it is.
It's the front yard.
The front yard.
Buffer.
They were supposed to, the buffer was supposed to stay, the buffer's been clear cut. We've asked to have a plan to remediate that, but anybody on this board seen one yet? Because I have not. Those are the issues that we have.
Just one quick question. Walter Pelkey sent a preliminary plan to Tad on June the 3rd or 2nd. You guys never saw that one either?
Yes, you did.
Yes,
had
we
those
did.
Plans.
No, so that one was denied? Or
that one was rejected. It's not. It was not.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Point of order.
Okay.
There are staff notes on that. Staff notes that were sent on the 8th. It might be in your packet. They were sent to Walt, Walter Pelkey. He had said, wow, okay. He had said, I'll address that. He wasn't sure what to do with it, but he did have them. And he said, well, I guess we'll talk about it at the meeting. And then on June 9th, there was nobody from J Group to represent sent that firm, and then we heard nothing, I heard nothing more from Walt, and I heard nothing more from we haven't heard anything more on this.
Well, there was no correspondence.
We were never even notified, we were on the agenda in June, but.
There was no email to anybody, never received an email, nothing.
Actually, you were, because I sent it to your agent, who was Walter Pelkey. I sent him the email, and I also, I sent him the agenda, I also sent him the notes. Sent them on the 8th, so they were sent to your agent, who actually did get back to me about it. Said, well, I don't know what to do about it, because there were some issues here, he said, I can't deal with it, so.
Actually, the last of the correspondence was on June 3rd. There was a conversation between you and Walter as to what type of red oak trees were gonna be used on the buffer. You had called out Alpha dash Q and Bravo dash Warrior, I don't even remember the name of the trees, but that was the last of it. Walter has never been notified of the June, what was it, 9th planning board meeting? I don't even know, the 12th?
6th.
6th?
That would have been the 9th, yep. Because the 6th was a Monday.
Yeah, I've got the email here that I sent to Walter at June 8th at 5:10 PM on June 8th and said, attaching my notes and revisions to the remedial plan. This is staff notes that were written on 6/6.
And there's an invite to the planning board meeting on that same email?
There was the agenda. I think the agenda was sent out to all the applicants. I don't have the email agenda on that, but.
Okay, well, that's, all right.
Yeah, I get that, but Walt was aware that we had a meeting on the 9th because I sent him the notes, and he called me and we talked about it. He said, what are you going to do tomorrow night? Well, just present the plan. We'll go over some of the deficiencies and see where the planning board goes. The notes that were stated also at that time also said for a planning board action, we were recommended a site visit. So the planning board could acquaint itself with the problem.
The previous Monday, though, that would have been June 3rd, 5th?
No, this was sent on the 8th. Notes were done on the 7th. And it was sent to him and said that one of the things that the staff recommended that we do a site plan, sidewalk, to acquaint themselves with the problem and to look how the plan serves or does not serve.
Oh, which you agreed to do the following Monday, right? The sidewalk.
I didn't agree to do anything. No, this was the planning board was going to have a sidewalk. Yeah, I went and looked back on the 3rd. I went to the site and looked at the site on the 3rd. That's why I came up with those notes, which I gave to your agent, who was Walter Pelkey.
We would have scheduled a sidewalk.
The planning board
on
was scheduled
the 9th, I was here.
If we weren't made aware that there was even on the, we were on the agenda. We were never even notified.
I mean,
had no idea.
I find it bizarre how three of us didn't show.
That's an issue that you need to take up with Mr. Pelkey, because he was notified. He's your agent. He's the person.
Well, Walter swears he was never notified.
If we go with history, the town planner never notified the abutters.
I don't receive any emails from the town anymore. I mean, there was a rumor that I supposedly blocked Mr. Redway. I mean,
well,
I'm not middle school anymore. I mean,
all my emails to you.
I mean, we did hire an architect to design something. I have it here in front of me. It's still aggravating because we have all the documentation that I have given to you guys that the state made us clear that and hammer all the rock out for the site distance and fix the back slope. This is something that we didn't have in our control.
Then you should have come and asked for.
But you guys were given this paperwork from the state.
We should have come and
it was all turned in
to change the plan, to show that we approved the plan that showed that buffer in existence. If you had to take that buffer out, then you should have come back to the planning board and said, we've had to make a change to this. We've got to change the plan. We've got to show you a new design on the plan. We've never been given that.
So isn't part of the process of the final application an MDOT approval of curb cut, driveway entrance? I mean, isn't that all part of the subdivision approval plan?
Mr. Chair, I think we're getting a cut for it. These details, I think, aren't as important as the fact that we need to just fix the problem.
Yeah.
You know, so sure, rather than get hung up on the detail, we all know that there's something non-compliant. So, right, how are we going to deal with that? I'd rather just focus on the remedy.
Well, we got sidetracked because I was confused as to why
I don't care about the dates really personally. We're here now.
Well, personally, because we've spent more money than we need to, we care about the dates.
You knew you were in non-compliance, and you still haven't received...
And we submitted a plan from Walter Pelkey that got lost in the...
Have you approached the planning board for that approval yet? I don't remember seeing you yet. So, and I'm just saying, in your favor, I'm just saying, let's get working on the solution, rather than debate...
There are two issues that need to be resolved. One of them is this landscape issue. The other one is the fact that you never gave us the surety. You never gave us the $152,000. That was a requirement of your approval. And when we were asked about it, we were told that you started work on the property immediately, way before you ever even gave us the approval. That's a serious issue. We do not have the $152,000 surety that we're supposed to have.
And we were promised that at the meetings twice.
Numerous times.
And we had the funds available. I mean, it was cash.
We never received that letter of credit.
We never got the letter of credit. We never got anything. And we kept getting told, we're going to get it, we're going to get it, we're going to get it. It started off in April. It went through May. It went through the town manager.
And that's when I put it on hold. Because we had a conversation where, and there might have been confusing...
Well, there's nothing confusing about the fact that the plan was approved with a letter of credit for $152,000. What's confusing about that?
The funds were in the bank. That's what's kind of confusing about it.
We did have correspondence with Mr. Redway from the bank.
You're way off. Nobody gets treatment like this. No applicant gets this kind of favor.
What? I'm not asking for a favor at all.
You've already got it.
What did I get for a favor?
6 months without the surety.
Nobody gets that kind of treatment. Nobody, ever, in the history of the planning board.
And I have to say, it doesn't look good when there's the someone from the Board of Selectmen that is getting that favor. We all look bad. The whole town looks bad. You know, and I don't like it. It's not good for our public image. And luckily, it's not out in the public, but...
Not good for the public image. What about a town official influencing the town manager?
That's what I mean. Like something that it could be called maybe...
How did I influence the town manager, John?
Well,
you receive special treatment from the town manager, which is not normal protocol.
How did I get special treatment?
It should have gone through the code enforcement officer as normal protocol. You were in violation on the first day you started construction. Simple cut and dry, and it should have been stopped right there and then.
Again, how am I getting special treatment from the town manager?
You didn't have to pay the surety.
Let's not have that.
Ted, question for you real quick in all this debate. One of the other conditions of approval was at least 5 days prior to commencing construction, subdivider shall be deposit a check for the amount of 2% of the estimated cost to pay for inspection fees. Was that ever done?
That was done when the excavating contractor asked for an inspection.
So after the fact, but
it was taken care of.
All right. I wanted to make sure we didn't have another issue.
Mr. Chairman, may I ask the applicant a question?
Yeah.
Please understand I came in after your application was approved. Can one of you all please explain to me what happened and why was the landscape buffer removed?
Because there was ledge up the side of Log Cabin Road that we had to hammer out for sight distance, and the state...
I'm sorry, what side? I literally don't know what sight distance is. I'm sorry.
To see down the road as you're pulling out of Scout's Way out of our road.
Okay.
Looking left, the state made us hammer all the rock out that was in the ditch line. There was no ditch line. The ledge was right up against the side of the road. And that's something we had looked at when we did a previous site walk. And then the state, on their requirements, wanted the back slope corrected. So we had to jackhammer the back slope. That was an added cost on our part. Which I have no idea how to remove ledge under trees without removing the trees. There isn't one buffer that had been touched other than the one that the state required we remove for site distance. Other than that, we couldn't get our entrance permit. There isn't one other buffer in that entire project that was removed. None. Except for the one that we gave you guys documentation on. And that's one of the reasons why it's so aggravating. Now we had to go out and hire a landscape architect.
I haven't seen any documentation supporting what you just said about DOT's requirement.
It was brought in, and I even highlighted all the stuff when I brought it to you guys last time.
Which would have been when? In June?
May 26th, May. And what had happened, basically, is that the grading plan that they were approved from, for showed the excavation of that material, but it was considerably less than what ended up happening. So, the grading left about a 15-foot buffer of that, and in just a short area, and apparently it got much larger than that in practice. So, the buffer that was designated to be retained was removed.
And from a planning board approval standpoint, you know, I get the practicality of what you had to do. You know, you came in and you described that and we talked to it. But, you know, we also discussed the need, really, because of that buffer. You know, it's part of the approved subdivision plan. And I'm not saying the buffer, when I say that, I'm not talking about just specifically which trees would need to be replanted. On the subdivision plan that's recorded, that all the homeowners would ever look to get into, any prospective buyer, shows a buffer in that area. So with that being removed, regardless of why, that subdivision plan, in my opinion, needs to be revised. And, you know, Mr. Pelkey probably would have been the one to spearhead that through the process. But to date, I haven't seen anything along those lines, you know, in addition to, you know, anything more from the landscape, you know, the actual plantings.
Because, like, all the documents from the state that said what we had to do, how many feet back.
Sure.
That was all included with this when they said that that's what we needed for the entrance permit, when the state finally did show up to
right.
be able to get our entrance permit.
And that's all well and good in your justification of needing to amend a plan. But to date, I mean, I'm not aware of anything, any submission for an amended subdivision.
I mean, I don't think we asked Walt to amend it. I mean, when the state gave us the paperwork on what we had to do, I mean, other than that, we don't get an entrance permit. It's a state road.
But I think, just so you can understand it, the state has their needs, but it may be in conflict with the approved plan that we all agree. We have the set of prints that we all signed off on that says there would be a buffer there. The state might have other plans, but we have to go back and then work on amending that plan, because you signed and agreed that you'd be leaving the buffer. Once you pull the buffer out, that's violation. So all we need to do, this happens quite often, sometimes it's field needs that require something to be changed, and that happens all the time. But then you have to go back to the plans and make the amendment. It could be a simple process, so we just have to complete that simple process, which we haven't seen yet. So I don't see it as a huge contention. This, to me, isn't as big of an issue as the surety, but the landscape thing could be a fairly simple, straightforward revision. That's all this is.
Well, we ended up we hired Mitchell Associates to draw something up over here. Because we were told that we had to have a landscape architect draw it up. It couldn't be anything Walt did, supposedly.
Is that something recently done?
Yeah, I just received this print yesterday.
It's dated 8/24.
Oh, that's what you just gave us.
And then I have the amount for all the products right from Dale Pearson and Pearson's Nurseries that go with it.
Those are 2-foot contours or 1-foot contours that Mitchell's showing on the plan?
I'd have to ask him.
I assume the one, can't be sure. Because he shows a berm. He shows installation.
Yeah, to be honest, I think it's a 3-foot berm. I think it reduces in 1-foot increments.
Verification.
So again, I mean, in my opinion, where this is submitted tonight, Ted, you need to have a chance to look at it, make any comments, that type of thing. So, I mean, really, it's great that it's been prepared. But we still need to go through the process on it.
At least one thing.
The application's still pending.
At least one thing. It's been so hot, even if it was approved, that it wouldn't have been able to be planted.
No, you can't plant right now.
Right.
I mean, unless you want to stand there with a water truck and...
Well, that addresses the issue of the plant. Do you have that on the...
One from Brian.
What paper do you want?
For that.
Yeah, they've already got it.
They've already got it.
Yeah. We now need to address the issue of the surety.
And then Jay says he already gave you the paperwork from the bank for the balance of what we have left.
No.
We're talking about, you were supposed to give us $152,000 on deposit with the town in a surety bond or a letter of credit. We don't have it. Before you started work, that was a condition of approval. Where's the $152,000?
It's been dispersed to all the contractors that have worked on it.
That's immaterial.
That's immaterial.
He asked me where it was, that's why I'm answering him.
No, I'm asking you for the $152,000 that belongs to the town.
And again, and I think in the notes on the agenda, we've asked for a rapid renewal, correct? Rapid drawdown?
The only thing balanced left is the final code of that subdivision, which is not going to be done until it's completely built out. And then that landscape buffer.
You haven't put it in the street trees yet, though, right?
No, I got the pricing on the street trees yet. The street trees we weren't going to put in until we built houses to see where the grades come out. Those are on 320 apiece. Because we're at 16, what we have balanced is like $16,700. So we just called our bank, they wrote us up something for 20 grand or something like that it was, to cover it up, and they, I guess you guys hang on to it or whatever.
I don't understand that, though.
Well, I don't understand either.
They don't want to see the 20, they want the 152.
And if you want to do the drawdown that you're supposed to do, give us the 152 and submit the plans for the drawdown.
So they want us to go back to Brian now and get a letter of credit for $152,000. That's what they're asking.
That's what we approved you for.
Right.
And you guys agreed to that. That was part of the conditions of approval. You haven't met the conditions of approval. This is what we started asking you for back in April. Where's the money? And we kept getting told that it had been delivered. It hadn't been delivered. We talked to Sim. She didn't have it. The bank was contacted. It had not been delivered. We have never gotten that. There was a pro forma line of credit letter that needed to be filled in and signed. But there was never anything that was delivered to the town for the $152,000. And you came in and said you had already started doing the work. The day we said, yes, you can do this, you started doing the work. Conditions of approval said you had to give us at least 5 days. It's an issue.
And the easiest way to resolve it, get us a letter of credit for $152,000.
To the chair?
Yes.
Could that be a letter of credit that's a drawdown letter of credit? That be the planning board's?
What do you guys think?
Oh, question on that drawdown part. On that drawdown line of credit, a letter of credit issued for the amount?
For the amount.
For the amount. Mm-hmm. Okay. But then they have also the proof of out of that amount, which has already been drawn down. So it's throwing a line of credit for the amount. Okay, so it shows a base load.
Yep.
Okay, But then after that line of credit has been approved, turn around, they can show out of that, which has already been paid for. So it's not turning on posting a new whole line of credit.
I agree with you, Marty.
You see where I'm going now?
I do.
I mean, that way it turns out it's not saying, okay, on paper it says a line of credit for $152,000. Okay? But turn out even that, it shows what you have drawn down out of expenditures already. So that it'll show the balance of what you have, what you say, $20,000. Whatever else, not now, which will show it will be stayed in, so in case it never does get done, not meaning it will, won't get done, but turn out there is ample to complete it. Because not like how we had that other project over on the old post, was it Route 1A, where that development was never, and we had to keep chasing after it to get it finally coded or something other. I don't remember the name of it, but something along that line.
James? No.
Okay. Chip?
I understand the practicality of what Marty is saying. I don't understand why this applicant didn't comply. I just don't understand.
The short answer, when we purchased the property, we had 17 and a half acres. Came with a residence, an existing house. We broke the 14 and a half acres off, 15 and a half acres off, kept 2 acres with the house, sold the house, and created Brookside Estates. And when we sold the house, obviously we inherited all that, the funds from the sale of the house. It didn't make any sense at all to go to the bank and say, we need to borrow another $160,000. We already had the funds in the bank.
Performance bonds, not borrowing
right.
money.
It's no, performance bonds. Just had to pay for that extra closing.
So it is borrowing money. Because
no, it's not borrowing money.
And Jason, the thing that... The
stop
thing
shaking your head at me, John.
You don't eliminate
anybody. Jay, sit down.
Don't fuck yourself.
Jay.
You are a select person. Please. You are supposed to behave yourself. I'd be ashamed of myself.
Yeah. Ashamed of you. What are you even doing here? Every time someone talks, you shake your head, and then you look at me. It's annoying.
John.
Like you.
Please have a seat.
Here's the problem. People in town do not make a distinction between this planning board and the enforcement of the rules and regulations and, frankly, the approved plans, plans approved by this planning board, that's supposed to be done by town staff. And I've got a huge problem with it. This is not a trivial matter. We're talking about assurance that a developer has sufficient financial resources to complete a project. That's what the surety bond is. And if you didn't intend to provide a surety bond when you brought an application to this board, that should have been in your application package instead of a promise for the surety bond. And it feels, quite frankly, like the applicant has been stringing along the town, saying, we'll give it to you next week, we'll give it to you 2 weeks from now, we'll give it to you on Tuesday, whatever, and now you're coming back and saying, okay, we've done the work, we want to just provide you a $20,000 line of credit. I understand that you apparently had the funds to pay. With that, I just had to get that off my chest. To follow Marty's logic, I think that it's very important that there are two aspects to a performance bond. One is to make sure that the work is done, but equally important is that the work has been paid for, that it's free of workman's liens. So if the board is going to accept a document with a face value of $152,000, but and an effective value, if you will, of $20,000, then the code enforcement officer or somebody on the town staff needs to have all the documentation showing that not just that the work has been done, but it has been paid for and the work, potential workman's liens have been released, just like any other general contractor would have to do. Is that possible?
Yeah. No. I know where Roger stands. I heard him earlier.
I like what you said, Chip, that it's not just the work, but it's any liens that the town would be held responsible for.
No, the whole idea is that when someone comes in and proposes that they're going to do a project, the reason the requirement for a performance bond is there is to make sure that the applicant has the financial resources necessary to complete the project. And I can't understand why the applicant said they were going to provide that and didn't.
And the most concerning thing...
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Tom.
Well, I have a huge problem with all this. Like Chip said, it's to make sure that the developer has the ability to handle the job. And it looks like maybe you don't have that ability. That's what it seems like. It should be a simple relationship with the bank. They have that letter ready to go. For some reason, we didn't get it. And all of a sudden, to say, well, how about 20? Where's that coming from, the 20,000? If we're gonna accept a lesser amount, it's gonna take a lot of detail for me to understand where that 20,000 comes from, because there's still a whole road to finish, some landscaping and other stuff to get done. So it seems to me like it'd be a lot more than 20,000.
What road is there to finish?
To the final coat. So, anyways.
That's $11,370.
Okay, so besides that point, it should have been in place 5 days. I'm looking at this, says before any construction activity commences on site, the applicant shall submit to the town planner monetary forms, $152,000, blah, blah, blah. And you signed it. We went over that. We met for probably 7 or 8 meetings, you guys. We explained that, and everybody signed. It seemed like that's a good deal. And then we didn't get it. And then we asked for it, and you said, oh, we sent it to you. And then we gave it another meeting. You said, well, I'll have it to you tomorrow. And it hasn't happened yet. So I don't know if the track record looks good that we're ever going to get anything. I say the town needs to put a stop work order right now. Get that letter of credit in there. Then you can continue to work. We would do that to any other applicant. We would. We've never had this happen before where someone didn't pony up.
Yes, we have.
Well, we put a stop work order.
It didn't matter. It didn't happen to what we did is we got outvoted and outruled.
I don't recall what that was, but on this issue, the money was required, and the letter of credit seems like it's ready to go, and I don't know why it hasn't happened. I don't know why we haven't seen it. And I also don't know why you were allowed to continue. That's a lucky break for you guys. You got the project looking like it's on its way, ready to sell some lots, but you never should have done a single thing. Somehow you were able to let the work continue. And I don't know why the board should bend over. And how will it look down the road when the next applicant coming in will say, okay, I'll promise the $200,000. Then the next month says, well, let's get the same break you gave to the chairman of the Board of Selectmen.
Yeah, we've already spent $50,000, so how about we just give you $150,000 next month?
Yeah.
If you had the $152,000 in the bank, the money necessary to complete the project in the bank, it shouldn't have been any, it's a small amount of legal fees and a small cost, but if there's cash in the bank, you get the bank to write your performance bond, boom, you're done. I don't understand.
Sorry, Jane Ann Worthy.
No, Robert, you're fine, I was... The biggest concerning thing to me is in my recollection through the conversations and deliberations we had, is you guys had asked to, because you were doing some of your own work, you had asked to have a reduced performance bond. And the perception that it gives is that you wanted a lower bond. You didn't want to go through with the $150,000 performance guarantee, whatever format it was in. We didn't have any other way to work around that in the ordinance. Said, no, this is what you've got to do. And you went ahead and did what you wanted to do, or didn't do what you didn't care to do anyway. And that's where it really puts us in a bad position.
My problem, I have a problem with the landscaping. I'll get over that. The bigger problem I have is with the $152,000 and the fact that we were misled on numerous occasions about what was going to happen. We've been misled since April about this money, and now you're asking for less. My opinion, we get the $152,000, or we have the CEO issue a stop work order and close the project down completely. It should not have happened. Jason, you're a member of the Board of Selectmen. You are held to a higher standard.
And I don't understand why all of you, starting with him, has brought this into this whole game. I don't get that.
Jason, I'm bringing it in because as a
What does that
leader,
have to do with it?
You are a leader in this town, and you are held to a higher standard.
You should be shutting yourself down.
You should not be putting another group of people in the town, another board, in the position of an uncomfortable position of having to say, get a stop work order issued and close that project down because a leader in the town did not do what he was supposed to do. And that, to me, that's the issue.
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to respectfully disagree with you completely. I don't care whether or what office he holds. I don't care if he's running for president of the United States. The simple fact is they submitted an application that required a performance bond of $152,000 before they started work. They were not supposed to start work for 5 days, and they started work less than 12 hours after this board granted approval without ever providing the performance bond. And there were promises and promises. It was your personal feelings about what a member of the Board of Selectmen should or shouldn't do are irrelevant.
Okay.
And to me, it's simply that this board is supposed to accept applications, deem them complete, approve the conditions, to have set conditions for approval, and reasonably expect that all those conditions will be met. And that hasn't happened.
And you're correct. That is, in essence, that is exactly what has happened. And I think that it needs to be remedied.
All right, Mr. Chairman.
What?
Question is, we approved a plan, okay? It has had glitches, okay?
Mm-hmm.
But where do we, as the planning board, which is not, because we're not code enforcement or anything else, where do we have the justification, because that is held up into the other offices, not down here in this office?
I agree with Marty. I was uncomfortable with the
We can ask questions.
I think it's totally reasonable to ask questions of the planner, but enforcement is not the job of this board. This board's job is to discuss and determine what are the requirements for an applicant.
But if the dilemma is that the what really is nothing. We have no jurisdiction. We have no enforcement abilities.
That's what I'm saying.
But all we can do is point out
to the CEO or some other office that, that there's something in violation.
Yes, but the fact is, Tom, we can point it out, but how are we getting it to be pointed out? Because we aren't necessarily privy to that to point it out to them.
Yes, we are, because we would have been notified that the $150,600-some-odd letter of credit had been posted.
When are we ever usually post normally told that it's posted?
The only
one we talk about is season cottages.
No, you've asked about
it. We asked about all of them, Monty.
Okay.
But
the reason this comes up, I mean, the buffer issue sort of exacerbated the bond issue.
Correct.
Because it's been the practice of the board that if a applicant is in violation of their condition of approval or, you know, whatever it may be, then we don't hear that application, right? A revision to it. So we, if I remember right, took the stance of not hearing the landscaping changes until the performance bond got cleared up. So to me, that's the bigger of the two issues.
Well, one is, okay, so if the trailer you say that, if I'm right, and I think that you are right, saying that, because one cancels out the other. You can't hear it until it turns out one is correct.
Right. We want to make sure.
Code violation.
Yeah, things
are. But guess what? We don't set the code. And
yeah, we don't. Yes. And
we set the code, we don't enforce it.
Right.
So I see if we have two options. We either wait for the surety to be delivered, or we agree to a lesser amount for whatever reason, based on whatever facts. I don't know if there's any other options.
I don't see where there's an option to wait for a lesser amount. Yeah. That's the amount that was agreed upon.
Yeah, personally, I don't, but I think that was part of our discussion.
Let me throw out a suggestion for the applicant, which is that you go to your bank or whatever financial institution you're going to get your performance bond from, and you submit to them all the documentation I talked about earlier. In other words, the performance bond is for this project, and here's all the paperwork showing what we've already spent on it, and we want something with a face value of $152,000, but Mr. Banker, now, we've already spent $132,000.
What normally happens in this process, Dad? They post a bond of $152,000.
There's three different things you can do. You get a letter of credit. Usually you pay for that. Mm-hmm. You have resources with the institution. That's a face amount. They usually state that there's two types. The most common one is tripartite. No, saying a letter of credit. The most common letter of credit is the U.S. Chamber of Commerce letter, which is a face amount. It's like a check. And it keeps the face amount for the term. Usually it's 1 to 2 years. It's supposed to be, most banks issue it for 30 days after the termination date, or the date in which all things are supposed to be completed. In our case, that's 2 years from the beginning of construction. And the second one, which is less frequent, is that the bank, that there's a drawdown in which the applicant requests that the letter of credit be reduced based on submitted invoices that have been paid, just like Chip says, documenting that the money has been, the engineer certifies the work's been done and the contractor certifies that they've been paid.
And the subs certify
the subs, yeah, paid. The subs. The tri-party, that Marty is correct in saying that's one of the ones that we use a lot of. That's when you have a cash amount, which the bank holds the money and the money is dispersed. The bank pays the contractors based on drawdown forms that are signed by all the parties, usually on a monthly basis. It's what we do with seasonal cottages, where we're talking about millions of dollars there, where we're drawdown every month, and all the invoices are submitted and approved. The engineers approve them all, and then they sign it, and the bank releases the money. So those are two methods that we use a lot of. The other one is a cash escrow, where the town holds the money, and we disperse it from our funds as the applicant, again, submits invoices that have been paid, and the town will draw that down. That's an escrow account. That's the other one that we've used. Recently, we've been pushing tripartite, because the town doesn't hold the money, the bank does. We have 1099s.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong also, Ted, you said we were not going to be doing bonds?
Let me
finish. The reason I'm saying that is because on that other road agreement, they had a bond.
Yep.
And let the bond lapse.
Yep.
So everybody was, the town was basically SOL. Sorry, out of luck. Because there wasn't anything there to turn to complete the final coat on that project.
Yeah, that was a letter of credit, Marty.
I thought it was a bond. I mean,
it wasn't a bond, it was a letter of credit. Usually the bond stays intact.
But
very few people use. We've got two outstanding that we have right now. The insurance company is required to notify the holder 30 days prior to basically canceling the bond. We use that for gravel pits, and we did use that for a road construction project. But the incident you're talking about was a letter of credit, a Chamber of Commerce letter of credit, in which it expired. It expired before we even knew anything about it expiring. That being expired in previous administration. Okay. And you're right, because in that case, the applicant wanted to be released from those obligations, and he reposted another LLC to cover the paving, and he did that, and then that LLC was released.
All right, so that's easy. We could solve that issue. The landscaping part. I mean, you said you wanted to go back and look at that, and then we'd have to come back and sit here. Can we just look it over real quick, so we see if there's anybody? We're going to have to ask everybody's opinion, anyways.
The site plan has to be amended. It has to show on the site plan registered in Alfred.
Well, no, we're not going to register in Alfred.
Well, no, we don't even know if we're going to accept this drawing yet.
That's right. You can't.
Right.
Can we look it over? I mean, because he's going to look it over in his office. And we'll be here in 2 weeks talking about it. You guys are going to wait another 2 weeks because we need to add another shrub. Can we just look it over real quick, see if there's any questions?
We have to deal with the letter of credit before we deal with this. That issue has to be resolved before we even have a meeting to look at this and discuss it. We have to resolve that issue. That is something we got told by the Board of Selectmen. If there's an outstanding violation, we don't look at anything until that issue gets resolved.
Well, that was the first issue. That's what raised the flag. That's what you guys just said. Because we violated
The letter of credit was the first issue.
First issue was the work was performed before the surety was in place.
So what's...
Well, you need a motion? Well, I guess I'd like to hear from the applicant whether or not what their proposal is.
I'll call the bank tomorrow. 152, whatever it is.
153,000. Let Brian get that over here. But that's why I wanted to talk about the landscaping. Try to kill two birds with one stone.
We heard that before.
So we can come back
to
one meeting.
So until that letter of credit is in the town's office, I don't want to hear any more about the landscaping.
Okay.
Meanwhile, is work able to continue at that site?
There's no work left to be done.
Well, the more important question is, can building permits be issued?
No, not at this point.
I knew the answer to the question.
Well, why are you asking me if you know the answer?
Because he wants it on the record.
That's up, not up to me, it's up to the code enforcement.
That is absolutely up to the code enforcement.
Hopefully we'll see you next meeting and we'll get this all behind us.
I'd like to get an email from somebody at the town tomorrow that the issue's resolved.
Anything else, Marty?
Rich?
You got something that would like to be recognized. John?
If I may make a quick comment, Mr. Chairman, the board would not have this problem and not be trying to resolve this problem if there had been proper enforcement from the town in the first place.
Good point.
So this is a problem that's been created for the board.
Right. And it was almost unfair for the board to be put in the middle of all this. Like Marty said, we have no jurisdiction in enforcement, but we had to keep on nudging it till we get to this point tonight. And it's unfortunate that, I'm sorry, but from the town hall, whether it's a selectman or a town manager or this code enforcement officer, it seemed like no one drew the line, no one did their job. And it's been 6 whole months, five months in 3 weeks. And nothing was done about it. And we were the ones that had to be the bad guys. And that's unfair to us.
It is not.
We don't get paid enough.
No.
And we don't get paid for sidewalks either.
If we had the authority to revoke an approval, that would make people sit up and pay attention, wouldn't it?
Yeah. All right, let's move on.
Okay.
Okay.
Gentlemen, we'll wait to hear from you on the line of credit. And the next item is the zoning deficiencies. We should have a list of all.
You should have that in the package.
It's
deficient.
The classic example that Tom just gave me, in one section of the ordinance for peak runoff, it says zero. In another section, within the same ordinance, I believe it says 5 CFS.
5 CFS, anything under 5 CFS. And as you know, this came up because we had two applicants come in who complied with one section of the ordinance, but were not in non-compliance with the other section. And it's just unacceptable. And unfortunately, our ordinance is written such that the stricter of the two, whenever there's a conflict, the stricter of the two ordinances applies. In this case, zero peak runoff applies versus less than 5 CFS peak runoff. And so to do that, Jamie, I expect you to tear it apart, okay? But I rewrote that section, which I believe is 713, trying to keep as much of the original intact.
Okay, but this was just that was an
illustration. I called it 520 because in the new format, assuming we're going to do with the new format, it's going to be called 520.
Right, but let's start at that's just an example of some of the things that we're looking at. So let's start at the very top, right, with section 2.2, the right-of-way, and work our way down through these one at a time so that we can make some progress and get these out of here. And I think this was this Chip's idea?
Yeah, well, he did mention the fact that we want to attack one at a time.
It was my idea to just say, you know, instead of talking endlessly about
the problems,
let's take one piece and fix one piece.
But Chip, you've only been here 2 months. How did you find out we talked endlessly?
I've been attending plan meetings longer than 2 months.
That's painful.
That's frightening. Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
One question, sir. So before we go into the right of way, I have one question. Is some of that water percentages that we're speaking of, is that anything due to former past state regulations or anything else? Because as this particular case of DOT requiring different changes from plans and everything else, some of it, when it might have been written, in the past might have been following some of the guidelines of former planners.
It may have, but...
That's why I'm asking the question.
It doesn't make any difference, because nonetheless, those problems are in there, and they need to get resolved.
There's a lot in there.
Let's work, and you're right, Marty, there is, there's a lot in there.
And I'm not aware of any standard that would have been in place that would have allowed for 5 CFS.
Okay.
And the reason, the reason why I understand, I can understand somebody's logic of doing it and thinking that that's a minimal amount. The issue that comes up is 5 CFS could be a minimal amount, depending on the size of the watershed, the size, you know, the amount of runoff that's coming down and being discharged onto somebody's property that didn't see it before. I mean, you know, 5 CFS, you could be changing, you know, your runoff onto a neighbor from 2 CFS to 7, which is pretty significant, or you could be changing it from 200 to 205. So that's where, to me, it's a little bit of an issue.
Rich said let's start at the top.
Let's start at the top.
Thank you.
The issue, if I may, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
The issue with the right-of-way definition that we currently have is that there's two different definitions of right-of-way in the world. One with real estate attorneys who rightly say that a right-of-way is no different than an easement. It is a right of passage over somebody else's piece of land. And that's true for driveways and even subdivision roads and so forth. Well, that's not true. The fact is, a right-of-way, as we regard it in land use and as land use attorneys look at it, a right-of-way is actually a street. It is the area of a street. It is what it is, the area of transport, and putting a right-of-way across the land with a street in it actually creates subdivision. It creates division of property. The right-of-way is, in fact, a fee parcel of land called a road, from which divides pieces of land, and from which you must also create lots, that lots are created from, and frontages and setbacks are all from the road right-of-way, not from roads, but from the right-of-way. So the road, for the right-of-way, has a different definition, because what it essentially means is that the way it's been used by a lot of people, it would not require setbacks the way that real estate attorneys have interpreted. So what we needed to do is establish that a right-of-way is really a street. When we speak of a right-of-way, it's a street. And it does, when it goes through a parcel of land, it divides that parcel of land where it goes through into two parcels.
Question.
All right.
We had a recent development, okay, back up on Enterprise Drive for the gentleman who makes the leather pouches for whatever. Do you remember where that I'm speaking of?
Yeah.
The back end.
Yeah, that was an easement.
The way it was described, it was a right-of-way.
Yeah, that's a real estate attorney's definition, but that's
not the same. I'm just saying, right-of-way is allowing passage. It doesn't necessarily give specifications or anything else. It's a passage.
Right.
It doesn't need necessarily also give power, water, or anything else to it.
That's right. That is a right-of-way slash easement. In this case, that's really an easement. And it should be stated as an easement, because that gentleman owned the land underneath it, and he was allowing the person to cross it, not improve
for his use,
just for personal use. So he retained a right to cross the land. When you use a right-of-way that we're using, the term right-of-way, associated with a street and a private way. And a private way is nothing more than a private street. We use, in our ordinance, street is a public street. It's not a public or private street. It's strictly a public street, and then we call a private way, which is really a private street. The right-of-way is always associated with either one of these things. What happens is, because of the confusion between right-of-way and easement, we get into some big arguments with attorneys over
so we have lots go underneath the road. And you remember we had a subdivision recently that you had to correct in which you had lots legally, the way they were described, went underneath the road and went on both sides of the road.
No, went on the other side of the railroad tracks. Yes.
Yeah, but there were two separate lots.
No, it was all originally one.
Yes, I know they were originally one, but they were considered to be two separate lots, and you'll see in the assessors as being two separate lots, because that's a right-of-way that's owned by the railroad. It's a piece of property. And so what it does is it divides that property, and it is another piece of property between that divides that property, and so you have that property is a legitimate lot on one side, and another lot on the other side. It creates two lots by its presence.
I have a question.
Fact is, you're the sticker on everything. Why don't you just put a definition, right away and easement? That would sort of eliminate
I'd just soon call it a street right away and just leave it at that.
But again, you don't have to build a private way to street standards.
Yeah, but it is a private way. Marty, when you do a private way, you're building a street. You're building access. The reason why you do a private way is you are creating frontage access for a lot, which is required in the town of Arundel. Every lot has to have frontage on a public street or a private way. That's in your section 6.3, whatever it is.
But you also have access to back parcels.
That's right.
But if it's all one lot, why do you have to call it access to the property from frontage? The only reason some of that was done because of 911.
No, it was done because the town of Arundel has long stated that every lot must have frontage on a public street or a private way.
Example for what I'm talking about. 12 Canes Way. Okay? It has frontage on Route 1. The only reason they had to turn around and put a 12 Canes Way because of 911. It's all one piece of property.
Okay. What we're trying to do is create a definition that clears up that street right away.
May I apply Strunk and White to this revised language? Well,
you can apply. Sure. I don't know what that was, but okay.
I don't know what that is.
It's basically keep the KISS approach to writing things.
Okay.
The underlying sentence, the right-of-way of a public street or private way shall not be counted as part of any parcel, and the boundary of the right-of-way shall be defined as the front line of any adjacent parcels.
Perfect. Okay.
Okay.
Want to repeat that again, Chip?
I can show you my scribble, my chicken scratch. Yeah, sure.
That's it.
That's easy.
Right.
It's just... One of the problems with our code, frankly, is the way it's written. And we just...
Simple is better.
That's nice, simple, the fundamental concept is there's a right-of-way. The right-of-way establishes frontage on either side of it.
Yep.
And the right-of-way, and whatever the right-of-way covers can't be counted.
Okay.
Yeah,
so how do you guys feel about that?
That sounds good to me.
Me too.
Okay. Let's make a motion. Because we're going to have to take all of this stuff to a town meeting.
So let me just also make one other point. Leah's had this, and she was unable to tear it apart because she had a personal issue. She was gone last week, so I will forward this to her, and I have a conversation with her tomorrow about this language. So I will submit this to her as well, and we'll see what she says. But that's why I don't have a
lawyers are not renowned for writing stuff in plain English.
I didn't say they did, but okay. It's probably wise for a land use attorney and the town land use attorney to.
I'm not disagreeing.
How does that affect the state lots? Because that is part of the other thing.
Well, the state lots are totally different.
Yeah.
You still had to have a private way, and you still have to come off
It's not a private way.
It's not a private way.
On an estate lot?
No. It's an access road. It's not a private, it is a piece of land owned in fee by the lot.
So it's a private way?
No, it isn't. It's part of the lot. It's the leg of the lot. It's a flag lot. It's the leg of the lot. It's owned by that lot exclusively. It's not used by any other person. No other person has a right to cross or to use the access.
Someone else may have a right.
They can give that to them, but it, well, actually.
That's not part of it.
It's not part of it. It's not a road. It's a driveway.
I move that we approve the amendments to section 2.2, subject to the attorney looking at it with the changes that I proposed.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded.
Who's first on the second?
Jamie got it.
Jamie got it.
Motion's been made and seconded to approve section 2.2 right of way per the language Chip has provided. Subject, of course, to the attorney. Any discussion?
Yeah.
Yeah, Mike.
No, yeah.
Oh, all those in favor?
Yeah.
It is unanimous.
Okay.
Modify 7.6 to reflect the federal references instead of the sunsetted Boca code.
Move to approve as written, as amended there.
I'll second it.
No discussion.
Motion's been made and seconded to approve the change from the sunsetted Boca to the federal references. Any comments?
Yeah.
All those in favor?
I said yeah.
Oh, well, Marty.
Sometimes you say comment. I didn't wave my hand.
I'll give you that one.
You said yeah last time for the Boca.
What's the sunset?
Boca went away.
We don't use Boca anymore.
It's obsolete.
How old is this?
Very old.
Your father was on a board with me at that time.
No, I think what do they call it today? Boca died before my father did. What do they call it today?
It was back 20 odd years ago.
Yeah. It was 1991.
Was it 91?
91.
I was on a board then, weren't you?
Okay.
Yeah.
What do they call it today?
ADA.
ADA.
You're right.
That's why 28 CFR part 36. Well, that's actually the design standards. But yeah, that's what it is.
It's Americans with Disabilities Act.
Yeah.
I've heard of that one before.
Okay. Good. That's ADN. And it's been around since George Herbert Marsh.
Any other discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor? It's unanimous.
Yeah, I'm doing both for you.
I'm sorry. Who seconded that?
Oh, I did.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's why we asked how long old it was.
Okay.
Okay, Jamie, you know a lot more about this than I do, a ton more. I have a question based on your example.
All right.
About runoff.
Yep.
Wouldn't it make more sense for the limitation on the increase in stormwater runoff to be a percentage of existing flow than a fixed number?
What are you referring to?
It used to be that let me put it a different way. Part of the current code says zero net increase in stormwater runoff.
Mm-hmm.
Part of it says no more than 5, is it cubic feet per second?
Correct.
Okay. No more than 5 cubic feet per second. My question is, just stepping way back,
mm-hmm.
wouldn't it make more sense to allow a de minimis increase in stormwater runoff, or let me put it a different way, can we discuss the possibility of allowing a de minimis increase in stormwater runoff? I don't know whether that might be 5% or 10% or something like that. So in the example you gave, if it's only 2 cubic feet per second right now, and then 10% is
2/10 of a cubic foot per second, which is pretty much zero.
Right.
But if the existing runoff from stormwater runoff from the property is 200 cubic feet per second, then I'm kind of thinking 5% might be more reasonable.
So the logic behind the whole stormwater management, and I think the intent likely in the proposed changes is to make it consistent with the other part of the ordinance where it does call for zero net increase, which that in turn makes it consistent with the state standards. So that any project that's in before us that would need to get a stormwater permit from the state inherently is going to have to meet the no net increase standard anyway.
Time out.
Yep.
So there's a state requirement that there's no net increase.
Correct.
No point talking about what I would suggest.
Well, there are projects that would come in front of us that may not require a state stormwater permit. So the state standard doesn't necessarily apply to everything. I think it's an acre of new impervious, correct? The logic behind saying zero discharge is because one thing that's not easily captured in the stormwater, any stormwater management regulation that I'm aware of, is the increase in actual volume of runoff that is produced by changing areas from pervious to impervious. So the standard that's pretty much been adopted, you know, uniformly in a lot of parts of the country is to say, okay, you sort of acknowledge that you're going to have an increase in total water, total cubic feet that are going from, you know, one property potentially onto another property. But we're going to control the flow rate so that hopefully it doesn't have any impact on, you know, erosion or flooding or things along those lines that would be detrimental to a downstream property. And essentially that's what stormwater management's all about, is to preserve either the integrity of a downstream property or the integrity of a downstream water body, receiving water body. So.
And the reason why we do net for every property is that we don't arrive at a cumulative effect. It's not just one
project.
Yeah. It's the cumulative effect of an entire watershed being developed over time.
Yep.
That can result in disastrous results. So rather than trying to apportion pieces to everybody, say, you know, control your time of concentration, control your runoff release. It's not that you're gonna have less runoff or equal runoff. You're gonna have more runoff. It's timing when it's released, so that we don't have a flood event or erosion event downstream.
Yeah, but two questions on that. One, fact is, I don't have the crystal ball to tell you how much it's going to rain or how much rain I'm going to get, which is also going to control your flow along the way.
Yeah.
And then second of all, you're making everybody turn around and pave in bituminous or whatever else that, which is also so the surface is not porous to suck up some of the flow of water.
Well, and actually, Marty, in the standard practice with people designing stormwater systems would be, you know, a compacted gravel surface is considered impervious or the same as paved, just because it, you know, you may get some very minimal absorption.
But you're right, Marty. There's technologies and techniques you can use to actually do absorb water. You've seen Paul Gadboy use drip strips. Rain gardens, which we talked about, you know, I don't like that term because it makes everybody immediately turn off, but basically it's how we have aisles in parking lots. You know, they're raised aisles with plantings and so forth. The rain garden is a depression where the water runs into there and collects and then infiltrates into the ground. It's an infiltration basin. You can infiltrate it, you can inject it, you can have porous pavement. Well, it doesn't look that great to me because it tree is thought. But there are various, you can put it underground. There's all sorts of different techniques you can use to recharge the ground, put the water in the ground and control it. Even if you run it around the site, so you change the time of concentration by running around the site, which is called watershed routing. There's all sorts of techniques you can do to get it back into the ground as much as possible.
Okay, so we'll get back to my question, though. Mm-hmm. If the zero net increase state mandate only applies to some of the projects that come in front of this board, then is it appropriate for us? It sounds to me as if it's only smaller projects that don't hit the threshold for the state, and those smaller projects are ones where there would be less net effect on the watershed, and the cost of getting the stormwater down to net increase down to zero is probably relatively greater on a smaller project. So what I'm suggesting is, is there some way to make a distinction between a project that's going to have to meet state standards and a project which is not? And if there's
a lot more regulations to achieve.
I'm sorry?
We can write more regulations to achieve.
Well, I don't
we're trying to make it simple.
Well, that's why we want the zero net, because it's there for everybody. And usually doing a zero net on a small project, sometimes the net is so small that we don't even it's in the standard deviation of the formula. So like if we get a 0.01 increase, we usually say that's basically negligible because there's such a standard deviation.
Okay, and then I've got another question. I assume this should be 2 cubic feet per second.
Yeah.
In 520.2.
Yeah.
No.
No?
Not the way I read it. Velocity is measured in feet per second.
Yeah, didn't I put
you have it in feet per second.
Yeah.
Thank you for catching me.
No, it's correct as written.
Yeah, velocity.
Oh, it is. Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah, 2 feet.
Now, again, that was going to be my question to you, Ted, is where
did that number
come from?
SES has considered that for a long time to be the erodible.
Yep.
Yeah, the erodible velocity.
Does that count in Ohio?
I hope so.
Where they had open water?
That was that. Wasn't that? I thought that was Louisiana.
Yeah,
Indiana.
So that's just discharging it into a receiving water tank.
Okay. So the concern that I have with that is a board may look to say, okay, how are we gonna assess, you know, in a 25-year storm, water coming off of the crown of a road and entering a ditch?
Well, I think it only deals with discharge off-site.
That's not what it says here. Oh, off-site. Yes.
Off-site
into off-site. Wetlands. Yeah. I'm sorry, off-site. I misread that.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, you can't did you see
completely,
that?
Right.
Yeah,
so that's what I was really worried about.
Yeah.
Yeah, micromanaging.
Oh, no. Got it.
Okay, so I'm wondering if I'm missing something here.
What's that?
When I look at the design standards in number one,
yeah,
you know, all applicable development activities cited above shall maintain zero net increase in stormwater runoff rates between pre-development and post-development. Okay. But then I go down to design methodology to number 3, and it says if runoff after development would exceed the pre-development natural runoff condition. Didn't we just tell it up in number 2 that you're not going to do that? There's zero net impact?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So why is
then it discusses mitigation measures. How you mitigate them.
Okay.
Oh, so a better way of saying it may be if zero net increase is not practicable on site or feasible with site designs. Is that what you're thinking up there?
I agree, but it seems to me three is irrelevant.
Yeah, it has to be part of their plan anyways, just to mitigate somehow.
If that's the case, okay, pre-development, okay, you have a...
Well, we can rewrite them.
Yeah.
Why do you write it? Just delete it.
You have your roads flat, okay? After you finally get your final coat on and your pavement and everything else, it's above it. So your water's running which way? Because you look at many times when they pave the road, unless they're regrooving it, all the different driveways, the water, the road's higher than the customer's driveway, and you got all the water running off the road into somebody else's driveway.
That's part of their plan, though.
Actually, the driveway belongs to the town in that section.
Or Route 1?
Oh, I was thinking of. I'm thinking of a subdivision.
Well, I'm giving you
the reason why I kept that is because that is part of what exists now. And the question was,
I understand, I'm all for rewriting
this whole bloody thing.
But well, I'm not talking about rewriting it, but 5.20.3, number three,
right,
is irrelevant in the context of what's in 5.20.1.
Yeah, I think it was right. Just dealing with the methodology of mitigation. It was just to alert them how to mitigate.
Well, maybe
and it could just say mitigation measures
can include. You know,
why do we even need to get into that? That's the bottom line is that they need to figure out how to have a zero net increase, and that's their problem. They need to have a licensed engineer tell us how it's going to happen.
That's what they're getting paid the big bucks for. It's not us.
So we should eliminate three.
523, number three.
Yes.
You all right with that, Jim?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It is repetitive.
It is. I mean, so really, you know.
Thank you.
Item number two, where we're getting back to the velocity.
Yeah.
In the geomorphology, that's the right word, of stream formation.
Nice word.
Yeah. If I remember correctly, from way, way, way back when, most streams are formed, the channels, you know, not the overbank or anything, are formed during a 2-year storm event.
Yeah.
Oh, and then Your larger storm events creates the overbank and floodplain areas, that type of thing. I think item number two is noble, but I think we'd need to have some clarification around it in which storm event that was calculated in.
Okay. I think they're all limited to 25, though.
Right, because that's the other thing is stormwater management evaluation design shall be based on a 25-year storm,
yeah, right.
Which I think that's not necessarily appropriate to the logic of using 2 feet per second with the velocity. Does that make sense?
I think
you're in this proposal. You know, you're if we were to choose that, yeah. Maintaining that low velocity is the way to go. I think we need to designate the appropriate storm event that's going to be calculated based on.
So you want an event lower than like a 2-year or 5-year?
Yeah, typically it would be, if I recall right, it would be on a 2-year storm event. So, I mean, that's not a very common requirement throughout the state regulations or a lot of other communities. So
what is it?
The restriction of the velocity to no greater than 2 feet per second.
So that is not, that's one of the things I had a question mark next to. So that is not mandated by the state.
Not that I recall.
No, that's not mandated by the state, that's the...
I mean, it's a USDA recommendation.
That's common soil erosion control practice, that's the threshold level, that you need to start armoring your basin, you need to put riprap in it. If you're coming down at higher velocities than 2 feet per second, you need to put in things like impact basins, so you don't create scour. It's basically to prevent scour at the discharge.
Okay.
But my thought, give me 2 seconds, Chair.
Yeah, absolutely.
My thought on that is if a receiving stream is accustomed to seeing higher velocities, and we're talking about off-site discharges, the applicant's not going to have any real easy, good mechanism to armor a stream, even though, you know, he's coming back and he's maintaining his flow rate at whatever. That's the same, so that the you know, as long as he doesn't change the area of the stream, the velocity is going to be the same. So I could see that being a very problematic requirement.
Okay. Yeah, so we'd probably have to make it a performance thing. So it shall not produce scour at the discharge point.
Yeah, and
what storm?
And that's
because in a 50-year storm,
but in a pretty common stormwater practice is to provide outlet protection by riprap or whatever at the discharge point of any storm drain pipe. You know, you put your outlet protection there, and then it helps to dissipate that exit velocity and allow it to enter on into the receiving water at a, you know, calmer manner.
So take away the performance standard of 2 feet per second and then put in scour shall mitigate any.
I'm ignorant about this, but say you have a piece of property that has it. There is a stream that runs through the property. Mm-hmm. It starts uphill of the property and it runs through the property, mm-hmm. and water is running through that stream at 5 feet per second.
Yep.
Before,
right,
when there's nothing but chipmunks and squirrels running around the property. That's what you're mm-hmm. talking about, right?
Correct.
Okay. So, and I guess the problem one of the problems I have with this section is that it's everything. It's, whether it's going into wetlands, water courses, water bodies, erodible soils, or tractor runs.
I think that's where I did a quick read of this, I was interpreting it as on-site into any kind of on-site man-made channel or anything like that somebody's creating, not necessarily an off-site. I think that item could pose some issues, and I do think it could be easily remedied somewhere with, you know, if we have any design standards for stormwater or erosion control, probably is under the more appropriate place to include, you know,
we can
adequate outfall or outlet protection, you know, where you're going to be discharging any concentrated stormwater runoff, whether it's a culvert or it's from a stormwater detention basin.
This is way too broad and doesn't take into account
larger.
I think it could
have a very unintended consequence for somebody, you know, discharging into a decent sized, you know, stream.
Well,
the Kenny Bunk River.
Or the Kenny Bunk River could be a decent sized stream.
But if that's the case, why not leave it there at the 2 feet per second in the next sentence? The planning board may, it says reduce maximum discharge, why not just say the planning board may modify discharge velocities? That, I mean, that way we could increase it or decrease it.
Because, and then, I mean, but again, if you maintain the CFS, cubic feet per second.
Right.
And you don't do anything to change the area in which it's going through, the velocity pre versus post is going to be maintained. That's just the math of things.
Okay.
So,
not understanding that, I'll take your word for it.
And
maybe that's what we should have, instead of putting a specific 2 feet or just a pre.
But inherently, it's not when we say zero peak discharge.
If you're saying that there will be no net increase in water flow.
Yeah.
The rate can't go up.
Right.
But the velocity can, because how you did put that discharge, the gradient of that discharge,
but not if not if
this coefficient of that ditch that you've got could be incredibly smooth, and you could actually accelerate.
But where you're discharging off site, you're not gonna be changing that.
Well, I mean, the only thing is that you could be discharging off site at a greater elevation. Let's say you've got a fill. Let's take lot 3, where we have a huge amount of fill. They were discharging down that slope.
So that's still on site.
Yeah, but where discharge is at, it's on site there, but at the bottom.
Right.
Where it comes into the gradient, where it's got an increased velocity because the gradient's been increased, then you are going to have a higher discharge velocity at when it goes in off-site onto the receiving waters than it does naturally because you've increased the gradient, correct?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the issue there is that if it gets to a certain velocity, and depending on conditions at the discharge, it could create scour. The objective is you will not create scour. So maybe the 2 CFS is a little too confining, that the issue is that there shall be no scour created at the discharge.
And I think what we need to do is maybe, you know, to alleviate your concern, have a provision for, you know, proper stabilization and
energy dissipation,
things along those lines that would, you know, that if we have a if we would anticipate a problematic situation,
yeah,
that we could then go back and push the designer to say, hey, you need to justify your design here. And it could be, you know, you're trying to discharge hundreds of cubic feet into a grass-lined swale,
right,
which, you know, is just going to get blown away. And they've got there are ways to go back and, you know, size your riprap channel to accommodate that. So,
you said stabilization. What was the other thing?
That was like 15 seconds ago, Chip. Okay. I had no idea.
How about if we were to take it?
I'm just wondering if this top section here does not already address.
Yeah,
that consideration.
Right.
Well, the only reason I would like to spell it out, gentlemen, is because remember, our engineers, when they go through this stuff, they go through our ordinance line by line in order to determine whether or not the applicant has in fact met all of the conditions of our ordinance. And they may not even look at that unless we specify.
Now, one other quick thought.
Your engineers from each town, are there different rules?
Yes, town to town,
there can be different rules.
I don't understand why 1C at the top of the second page here doesn't cover.
That's allowing
stormwater increase. Impact mitigation. It looks as if it addresses that issue in 522.2.
That's volume, it's not the velocity.
It says rate.
Yeah, but that's...
What volume and rate is...
That's a rate of release, it's not necessarily velocity.
Well, how about we eliminate 5.20.2.2 and put something in, whatever that is, 5.20.41C.
Right, increasing the volume, rate, and velocity.
Volume, rate, or velocity. Well, I'm sorry. Volume, rate, and velocity. Does that work, Jamie?
Say that again. I'm sorry, I was reading.
1C at the top of the page.
Yep.
If it says documentation by the designer that increasing the volume, rate, and or velocity of runoff from the proposed development will not aggravate conditions downstream or upstream.
Yeah, I mean, to me, yeah. I mean, what's the logic, Ted, on upstream? What kind of scenario were you thinking?
I'm not thinking of anything. That's what's there. That's what
this is in the ordinance.
That's what the ordinance
says.
That's
what the ordinance says.
Oh, it does?
Yeah. This is not a new thing. I just took it.
I'm sure that Joel Fleischman could come up with some scenario where you could do something on your property and it would impact upstream.
So remember, my amendments, my changes are underlined.
Yeah, right. They are.
And it's struck out. What I'm suggesting.
No, wait a minute. I'm sorry. Upstream could be something.
It could. And I'm thinking of if you've got a culvert or a situation in place like what we're looking at with the boat storage area,
yeah,
where they're putting in, that could exacerbate an upstream condition.
It could.
So actually, I take back the nasty thing I said about a former town planner.
Why?
It'll come back.
Why?
Not because he doesn't deserve that nasty thing.
I didn't say that, okay. My other question is on that is, you talk about upstream or downstream, why didn't this NEL apply when they were playing with the dam? Because you turn around and change it upstream and downstream flow.
It's not stormwater runoff.
It is too. When you turn it on, you have.
I don't think they changed the volume or the rate.
They didn't.
Of course they did.
Well, they didn't do any.
For a few hours.
Okay.
I can't believe it.
So, how about that with this? Can we do this?
So, hang on.
Go ahead. I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman.
No. I just want to clarify. Are we? So we're looking at changing over here in 1C to volume, rate, and velocity of the runoff. Are we talking about eliminating 5.22.2?
I was going to suggest different language for that because I think that might eliminate all the rest of the stuff if we did it.
Okay.
I was just going to say no runoff shall be discharged into offsite into wetlands, watercourses, water bodies, or onto erodible soils at velocities that will create scour in the receiving waters. That simple.
Or just say, that will create scour
the soils.
But put in the definition of scour, because you might know what it means, and I might know what it means after having talked to you, but that doesn't mean that the applicant coming through the door knows what it means.
Jamie's not doing an answer.
Huh?
He's not doing an answer.
What I'm thinking, instead of, I'm
right.
thinking of something that we are going to tell them what they need to do, not what they need to prevent. That's to me is cleaner from a, you know, as somebody reading the ordinance and having a predictable outcome at a planning board.
Well, that's why I wanted to see it.
Right.
Yes.
I'm trying to think about how I would want to tweak that verbiage. You know, almost to the point of saying, you know, can't be discharged, you know, without adequate protection of outfall or something along those lines. I don't know. Nothing's coming to me.
Rain
earth shattering tonight.
Well,
I was thinking, I know you think of it as negative, but I thought it was a very clear creation, a very clear thing to avoid, that creating scour covers all the issues we're talking about.
Yeah. No, the scour is what? A rut?
Erosion.
Erosion.
A rut.
Not necessarily.
Not necessarily.
I mean, it could be where, if it's coming out into the, you know, an
make
angle.
It a rut, turn it, make it a hole in the, so it's a water channel.
It could be.
That's what I call it.
Could be
a scour.
Scour usually is in a water situation where the velocity of the water coming down erodes the bottom of the water course or the bed or even on land.
What would be wrong with just saying that the velocity cannot increase? Because the only way you get scour if it's an increase over what was pre-development.
Well, because I think you're going to get velocity increases in discharge or runoff if you have a gentle slope. You know, we're just using the example of lot 3. We were out there. You know, where they're going to do all that fill, that cut and fill. They're going to raise the size of that, raise the elevation of that building, and they're going to discharge over the side. That discharge over the side is going to be at an increased velocity because the gradient, they're increasing the gradient. So it's going to be an increase.
Well, then, maybe it shouldn't be allowed then to have it that steep.
And it's yeah.
Well, so, because it will be scouring it with
the
steep.
The objective is to prevent the scour. That's the objective.
The plan included riprap on the slope specifically to mitigate anything.
Which will mitigate the velocity. So, in the end, it's no increase in velocity.
I think you always get you can have velocity increase as long as you mitigate it so it doesn't cause erosion when it's released.
I think we're going to have to come back and address this at another point. It's 10 minutes of 9.
Whoa.
So if we can.
Okay.
Sorry. Good job. You missed it.
How about if we jump over this and go to the other three?
But this is a start, guys.
Yes, this is. Yeah. And we've made a fair amount of progress, even on the stormwater, because we've made some adjustments.
Yeah.
If you look at the very last page.
Yeah, can we get those up?
821.3.22.3 changes, it goes from maximum building coverage to maximum lot coverage.
Was that our intent at the time?
We had a different definition for building, but we kind of building coverage versus lot coverage, and somewhere along the line we decided not to do it, but we didn't take it out of the ordinance.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Okay. Well, it seemed all right to me, but
Well, the problem is when you actually apply it, building coverage is the building. Lot coverage. The definition of lot coverage.
Any impervious.
So the issue
which
is,
includes the building.
Which includes building, but includes parking and sidewalks.
Yeah,
and
sure
so that's what
grass.
It's supposed to be. That's what it should be.
Good. All right.
So building crept in there and it's in the snow.
Does that include your landscaping buffer?
Nope.
So what are the different lot coverages, amounts, limitations that we have in those zones?
70% almost across the board.
Okay. That seems about right for a lot coverage, not a building coverage.
Yeah. Right. That's in the high-density district. Yep. 70% is by normal.
Right.
And that's, if you think about it, that's a pretty urbanized lot.
Yep. Okay.
Do we want to have a motion on this, the third page here?
Yes.
On the
third page.
Stormwater, sure.
I make a motion that the deletion of building and replacement with a lot in 821.3, 822.3, 824.3, and then the replacement of impervious surface with lot coverage in 825.4 be made to the land use ordinance.
I'll second it.
Motion has been made and seconded to accept the changes for building and lot coverage and impervious surface. Any comments, any discussion?
What does it do for the landowner?
Nothing. No. But it doesn't do anything to him either.
Right.
Are we giving or taking? No, that's what I have to do.
You're not doing either.
For fencing. I didn't know if we're putting another restriction somewhere.
That was my concern, too. If we are, then you raise a good question. My understanding is we are simply simplifying, we're making it consistent.
Okay.
Motion has been made and seconded, all those in favor?
Yeah.
Alright.
It's unanimous. Planner's report.
Let's see.
Camera on or camera off?
We've got a number of things, as you know, our agenda basically contracted rather quickly. I've talked to Atlantic Mini Storage people, they still have not heard from DEP. They went into Jamie's motion at the last meeting regarding increase. They do not have a strategy yet that they've submitted to them. And they will get back to me next week, when they get here back from DEP on the question that Jamie asked.
Now, that creates a problem for us, does it not? 30 days after the public hearing?
Yeah.
Is the next meeting?
Yeah.
So we...
I'm advertising for a public hearing.
Okay.
Okay. So, just because we had the public hearing doesn't mean the planning board can't ask for an extension. Or what the owner can do is grant an extension. We've already talked about that. That is possible. Because we have to act by the 8th, that's the problem.
Right. So they have to give us an extension, or we have to give them an extension?
No, they give us an extension. By the site plan law, we are required to act within that time period, and that's our drop deadline.
So if they
can't meet the standard, then the planning board would be obligated to deny the application.
Correct.
They can grant the planning board a 30-day extension.
Who? The applicant?
The applicant, because it's their right to have an act. The way we wrote the site plan ordinance, they have a right to get a decision within a specified time period. No extending it out forever. So they have a right to get that. They exercise the right to give the planning board an extension to make that decision, because it's in their best interest to do so. They certainly don't want to deny it.
But have they given us the extension? Or will they give it to us on the 8th?
They will give it to us on the 8th if necessary.
Okay.
They may get the answer that you were looking for, Jamie, before that. And that's what they're seeking to do. So I've already written up the findings of fact. And I can write up the findings of fact for the opposite, which I will have to do if I can't hear anything before the 8th.
So they know that if they show up and ask and tell us that they'll give us an extension, that they're in good shape. But that if they don't, then they're probably going to get voted down.
Yeah, I've already discussed this with Michael.
I just want to make sure.
Please put it in writing?
Yeah.
We want to make sure that they understand.
In fact, I think I did put it. It's an email, I think.
That's pretty good.
I'll send you a copy. Yeah. I'll do it again. Good point.
The board's.
I don't want this crap happening.
I was just surprised to hear that they would be telling us if they have an extension.
That's right. We're glad I asked the question.
Well, and it's to prevent the situation that,
Next. Could not get the public hearing in time for the cottages, so they're to push back to the 8th for the public hearing. It's just well, because guess what, the chief, they still have not arranged the cone test, which the chief had requested. So I don't know when that cone test is going to occur.
Who's the delay?
I don't know.
Is it on their side or the fire department's?
I don't know.
Okay.
I asked the fire department, have you done the cone test yet? They said no. I said, apparently they have to do it in another location because they can't move that tanker truck.
That water truck.
Oh, yeah. Water truck, thank you. Yeah.
They got to set it up.
So they're going to
set it up. Well, it's simple. Start the thing up and move it.
Okay.
I know a lot of water trucks.
So if you want to ask whose fault it is, it's the applicant who needs to set it up in a different location. Okay? So that's they haven't made arrangement on that. I was talking to Randall today and didn't have any more information on that. So until that chief is convinced that he can get that truck turned around in that oblique angle, he's not gonna give us a green light on that. What's interesting, gentlemen, is if we look at we'll discuss that another time. if you look at phase three, which is the next phase, which they cannot proceed until they bust through to Mountain Road, you'll see that we have a porcupine design, as I would call it, because it's a loop with all these spines off it, and each one of them dead ends. Four units on each of the dead ends with no turns.
No.
All you approve them. It's not their fault.
And that's because the future plan is to have all those spines continue?
No.
No?
No. Secluded. That's approved. Can't do anything about that. So the fire department, they're short and they're all straight, so it's backable. They can back a truck in. Yeah, they can back a truck out pretty easily. The compound curve that we've got and the oblique angles there are the problem with the current design. It's a real tough thing.
You're talking about the compound curve for the three or four extra.
Yeah, for the four units, yeah. On Great Hill Road, that we'll call it Great Hill Road, because that's what I'm saying.
The private cottage, the private clubhouse, is what we call it.
Yeah, exactly. And then the third one was, I had a talk with the owner of the property regarding lot three. We talked to Leo today. He came and sat down with me. And he's got pretty much of pretty ironclad right to use that well. And apparently they have not come to a resolution on what to do with the well at this point. So, nor have I received the buffering the chip requested, any designs for the buffering the chip had requested. So,
Board requested, I just suggested it.
Obviously you were convincing. the board suggested, yeah, the board requested that. And so those two basic issues, which were pretty important issues to the board, have not been addressed. So that's why they were yanked from the agenda. I have sent off a message to Dan saying, get back to me. You know, tell me what your plan is here, especially after my meeting with Leo. And Leo's the one who approached me on it. So he told me some of the history there. But apparently the negotiations are still in progress.
Because that was all done for approval to turn out even to come in there.
Yeah, well, the problem is there's an encumbrance on the lot which they intend to violate. And they don't have a right to violate that encumbrance. They cannot fill over that well.
Yeah.
That well is a drilled well, by the way. It's not a dug well like we surmised. That casing around it was put in for protective purposes, but it's a drilled well. You know, since it goes down 350 feet and so. Anyways, other things we have, as the closing came for the contractor yard, we have registration. Wasn't a popular thing, by the way. A lot of people are just happy with being non-conforming.
Well, I'll tell you, probably, truthfully,
really,
nobody even knew about it.
Well,
I'm just throwing it out.
Who would be affected by it? Would be cottages, they're going ahead. Another drawdown. I think I made the drawdown when we spoke. That's all I've got for you. Let's get out of here.
Okay.
And what about that one? I threw out about a vendor.
What about the vendor, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, I've met with the vendor.
To ask the board.
Yeah, the board has got...
The board here. We approved it before.
We haven't approved anything.
Yes, we have. We have approved one to turn to be operating in town.
Okay, you're going to have to tell me about that, because I don't
know. Well, the little Chinaman. Turn around and... Yeah, the little Chinaman next to Jay Brothers. He had a permit to turn around to operate his hot dog and sausage cart there and everything else.
That's not Jimmy Pack, was it?
Yes, it was.
He's Korean. Okay.
And because at one time or another, we had somebody else along the way up at Champagne Energy wanted to put one in, and he was refused there because the time factor was, he didn't, there wasn't enough safe parking, because he wanted to operate basically almost off Route 1. And then, because there's a little garage there.
Yeah.
Okay, but Jimmy Pack came down later on, afterwards, and where right next to Rainbow Market, or J Brothers is, that section there, he operated for over a year.
So you're asking, you're talking about food trucks?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it was permitted years.
Yes.
12 years ago, maybe?
Long time.
No, it wasn't that long ago.
Well, the fact is, the code enforcement officer has basically said that they're not cited as a permitted use in the district, and therefore they're not permitted. I talked to the gentleman who runs it, and I said, what you want to do is submit a letter to the planning board requesting that the planning board consider food trucks on Route 1, or within whatever district you want to say, and ask them to amend the ordinance to allow that. Mm-hmm. He said he's got at least a year or two before he has to vacate that premises.
Just something we never
so that was the instruction I had given to that gentleman.
Yeah, but we've had it.
And that's Mike's, it's basically Mike's operation.
No, this wasn't Mike.
Well, he gets his food from Mike, that's right.
I realize that. But the fact is, we have had that usage in town.
Right, but you don't now.
We never took it away, because it turned out it was allowed. There was somewhere there along the way it was allowed. We never took it out. We never scratched it out. I'm telling you.
It's not in the ordinance.
It's not in the ordinance, Mike. It hasn't been in the ordinance.
It's worth considering.
Oh yeah, it's something for the board to consider. I mean, but in the 2009 ordinance or 2007 ordinance, it wasn't in there. Because I think that's when Mike first came up with his food truck.
This was
when he first approached. He went to the selectman with a request because he didn't need to go because it was going to be on private property. Our ordinance on vendors is on sidewalks, which we don't have, and public right of ways, which we do have. But our vendor licensing process that we have in the town of Arundel is strictly dealing with food vendors within the town property.
Town property?
Yeah, that's what the ordinance
says. I mean, owning somebody, the town can own.
Town property, public property. I should say public property. It's within rights of ways and along sidewalks.
That's okay, what's Commerce Drive?
Well, that's something totally different.
Commerce Drive is private, yeah. It's a street.
Yeah, but what I'm saying, no, it doesn't apply. And that's what I told him, and that's what the lady said, that ordinance doesn't apply. It didn't apply to Mike when he applied to the selectman at that meeting. He should have been there.
I don't consider it business friendly.
Well, the simple fact is that right now, for quite a while, the ordinance has not allowed food trucks. And if you want food trucks, the planning board should give me that instruction. I told the owner to come and talk to the board, send a letter to the board. Now, since you're talking about that, I also have a letter from another property owner who would like us to take another look at home accessory apartments, and I will give it to you, but basically they would request that accessory apartments not have to necessarily be part of the primary residence, that it could be a separate standalone facility. Okay.
How can they not be? Excuse me.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. It's an accessory apartment.
Well, the request has to be made, and the board should schedule a time to talk about it.
Yes, we should. Okay.
I wanted to bring up something I would like to talk about at some point now tonight. Okay. But it disturbed me that there is something in the timing. When the board approves something and a notice period for the public hearing, which made it impossible for the golf course to get a public hearing until late September or something like that. At our last meeting, Maybe you and I need to sit down.
No, I'll say publicly here, because the board is aware of this. Conditional use permits must be advertised 10 days prior to the meeting. Newspaper requires 3 business days before they will publish that legal ad. We have to advertise in a paper. It's a very archaic methodology from a different era. It's from the last century, really. But it's still required both by state law and it's required in our ordinance. So we have a 10-day requirement, 10 days prior to the meeting, which is usually the Monday. When I submit, Friday morning.
Is 10 days the, is 10 days the state requirement or the town requirement?
It's the town requirement.
Okay.
It's a state requirement in many, for many things. So that's where they came up with it.
Where I'm, you know, what I would like to discuss is at a later date, is pros and cons and possibilities of being able to have an applicant come in here with a perfectly reasonable request and be able to have the public hearing at the next meeting.
You were to do that, or you would probably, you need to reduce it from 10 to 7 days. That way I can advertise it.
Every 3 days.
Set it up.
Can
I make the 3 days and I make the
next one.
Would you put that on the agenda, Ted? Because the problem right now is that we have a 14-day submission requirement, but with the 10 days and the 3 days for the paper, it's 13 days and we're already past the next meeting.
And when you're talking about the last century, perhaps in addition to notice on in newspapers, which nobody reads pictures,
but newspapers are state requirement.
It is the state requirement.
I understand. What I was going to suggest is that we add the requirement that it be put on the town's website.
It is always, anyways.
I don't care that it explicitly be on the town's website.
I think it is. Actually,
no. If it is, fine. We'll talk about it next time.
Yeah, I think it is.
I think it is a site plan because I wrote it in there when we wrote a site plan. It is on the website and in the newspaper.
Okay. Anything else?
That's all I got.
Is the motion we adjourn?
Second.
We're out of here.
Time.
Turn the camera off.
9:08.
Turn the camera off.
Second. 5 seconds.